Good morning, Encounter at Home. I'm Emily. Thank you so much for being here with us this morning. Text where you or comment where you are watching from. I know it's a holiday Sunday, so maybe some of y'all are out of town. Lots of fun. Excited for you. I wish I was out of town right now, but here I am with you today. So win-win, right? All right. So if it's your first time watching with us, this morning, text WELCOME to 501-510-6020. We want to get you a gift. We want to reach out to you, pray with you, anything that you need. We want to just connect with you. Oh, maybe you're supposed to text CONNECT to 501-510-6020. It's a holiday weekend, guys. Give me a break, okay? Text CONNECT. I'm so sorry. Okay. So we have our giving wall up, our angel kids. They're available right now. You can take a paper home with you. It has all of their like clothes sizes, all of their interests, and you can help give a child, two children, 20 children a Christmas if you're available. So you can get a kid next Sunday if you want. I think next Sunday is the last Sunday to pick up an angel kid. But you can also, if maybe you live out of town and you want to help, you can also email info@encounterchurch.tv and we can get you a kid and all of that stuff. We can get you situated. We have a worship night on December 10th at 5 p.m. at our village campus. So if you haven't been to a worship night, it is so fun. It's such a good time. Amazing worship. We have all of our incredible, incredible worship team a part of it. It's really awesome. It's going to be really powerful. We haven't done one in a while, so now is the opportunity to come to one. And you can follow our social medias for updates about that, address and all of that stuff. And then finally, before we go into service, our Christmas services are coming up so fast. We'll have a Christmas Adam service, get it? Because Adam came before Eve, get it? So Christmas Adam service at our village campus. At 5 p.m. or 6 p.m., sorry, and then two Christmas Eve services at 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. here at our Springs campus. So, super excited for that. Invite all your friends to that. I think there's some events for all of the Christmas services and the worship night on Facebook. So, share those, say that you're going, just help us spread the word. And worship is about to start, so let's get in there.
This bag of bones. There's a place when the heart is on the fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between what we used to be and the second name, I know I'll never be alone. There was another in that fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There was another in the fire. All my dead left the dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I fall in the space between what remains of me and the second me? Either way, I'm about to the things of this world. Should I ever need reminding? joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be. I count the joy come every battle, cause I know that's where you'll be.
Wow, you may be seated. Y'all look good today. Turn around and smile at somebody really, really big and ask them if they ate way too much this weekend. And if they say no, then ask them why not. I was telling some people before service, I ate way too much and I don't feel bad about it. I do feel bad about it, not emotionally. Physically, like, that's a whole nother story right now. You guys look great this Thanksgiving weekend, and we're so honored to have you here with us today. My name is James Turner. I'm the lead pastor here at Encounter Church, and we're so honored that you're with us. We're also honored that you're watching online. Can we give it up to everybody watching online right now? Thank you guys for letting us come into your home today on this weekend. Those that are traveling, we've got a lot of people that are traveling this weekend. It is the highest travel weekend of the year, and so be praying for protection of those that are on the road and in the air and all that stuff, especially those in the air if they're flying American Airlines. Anyway, so if you don't know, you don't know. But if you do, you do. But man, it is a great weekend. Again, we're so honored to have you guys here. I want to give a big shout out and a big hand clap and congratulations. Yesterday evening, we got to celebrate a great wedding for Blake and Mallory. And we're so honored. And Blake wasn't supposed to be on the stage, but he's like, this is what I do, and I want to be at church. And so some of y'all need to pay attention. Like, the day after the wedding, he's on the stage by his own choice, not ours. We didn't force him. We didn't coerce him. We didn't threat. I've threatened, but not for that. Other things. But we're so honored. His family's here with us today. Thank you guys for being here. What an amazing weekend we've been able to have so far. I want to talk to you about tithe and our offering today. I'm not used to holding a microphone, so this is awkward for me, but we're gonna work through this. Genesis chapter 25. Most of the time, especially in November, when we talk about giving, we talk about giving outside and what it does for our community, and we've been able to bless, man, just a lot of people this Thanksgiving month. We literally take the whole month and have been able to bless some people, and just excited about that. But I want to talk to you today about what giving does for you. Everybody say, for me. Not me, you. Everybody say, for me. No, not me, you. You're going to get it on the way home when your wife explains it to you. Genesis chapter 26, I want to read to you. Verse 1 says, there was a famine in the land besides the previous famine. So we got famine times 2. It's like famine 2.0. Anybody feel like in life right now you're in famine 2.0? Come on, don't be afraid. Raise your hand. I got mine up right now. There are times and seasons where it feels like you got the Midas touch. Everything you touch turns to gold, and it feels like you just can do no wrong. Anybody ever had those moments before? Like, you get the raise, and you get the promotion, and you get the girl, and all that stuff. But then there are other seasons that are the opposite of that, and you have a different kind of touch. If you've seen the movie, it's a cheese touch. Anybody know what a cheese touch is? A cheese touch is when you touch everything and it turns, well, not gold. That's a famine season. I just out of curiosity, I mean, I know what a famine is, but out of curiosity, I looked it up and I wanted to see, what is the actual definition of a famine? It's a season where there is a lack of resources, specifically water or food. But there are many times that we go through seasons that we have a lack of resources in our life, right? Where you feel like times are just kind of tight. It's a little difficult. Going into the holidays is always one of those seasons for people. It is the highest season of people going in debt and people feeling the stress, anxiety, and all of that. Because, you know, you got Christmas presents and you've got all of these things you've got to live up to. Well, in that time of famine, in that time of not enough resources, there are two responses. You can get, in the old phrase, we've heard this before, it sounds trite, but it's true. You can get bitter, or you can get better. So we know how to get bitter. You find two or three people, you gripe about how everything's going wrong, you sit around and stew on it, or you choose to get better, And the Bible gives us a recipe for getting better. Isn't it cool that everything we face in our life, the Bible gives us a recipe on how to get through it if we would just read it? So if we skip over, same chapter, chapter 26, verse 12, Isaac now is in this place of famine. The Bible says he takes his family and he goes to a city called Gerar. And he gets to Gerar, like one of the Geranimals. He gets to Gerar, and he the Bible says he plants in that land in the same year when there's famine 2.0, in the same year, and he reaps a hundredfold because the Lord blessed him. He began to grow rich. His wealth continued to grow until he became very wealthy. He had so many flocks and herds and servants that the Philistines, an entire nation, began to envy him. In the time of famine 2.0, not just the famine, but another famine on top of a famine, he began to trust God, and God brought blessing into his life. And then verse 19 of the same chapter, it says this. It said, Isaac's servants dug in the valley and discovered a well of fresh water there. He named it Rehoboth, saying, now the Lord has given us room. We will flourish in the land. Here's my key point to you on this tithing message, little snippet for you today. Keep digging. Keep sowing. Don't stop because it feels like you're in a time of famine. Because in the time of famine, God says, that's when I want to show myself strong. Here's what I found in Scripture, if you read it. Every time God wanted to challenge somebody, he didn't bring blessing, he brought famine. When he wanted Abraham to move, he brought famine. When he wanted Isaac to move, he brought famine. When he wants you to move in your life to another place and to be able to receive his blessing, he doesn't take you from blessing to blessing. He takes you from famine to blessing. And so if you're in a place of lack of resources right now, you feel like you're just not able to do what God's called you to do right now, good, join the club. Because what that is a setup God to be able to give a comeback into your life. God to be able to put you in the next level of blessing and favor in your life. And without the famine, you'll never experience the blessing. But without the seed being sown in the famine, you'll also never experience the blessing. You'll just stay in the famine. Isaac could have said, you don't sow seed in the time of drought. Now, I've done quite a bit of gardening and farming and stuff in my life. I grew up on a farm my grandfather had, and we used to do all the stuff. We used to plow the field and pick the green beans until we were so sick of green beans and potatoes we couldn't stand it. Greens, beans, potatoes. Sorry. I don't know where that came from. It just came out there. But I do know this. If there's no water, the seed doesn't grow. And yet God says when you sow, miraculously, in the time of famine, I'm going to bless you. So let me ask you one more time. How many of you feel like you're in a time of famine in your life right now? I'm talking to you today. You're here and you're in a time of blessing. Everything's going wonderful. So anyway, because you want the blessing to continue, you got to keep some seed in the ground. We're going to pray together. I believe God's going to do some amazing things. Whether you're watching online or here in the room, the way to give her on the screen for you, let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity, the recipe that you've given us in Scripture to be able to bring blessing into our own life. God, I thank you that this month we have spent so much time sowing into others. We have spent so much time blessing organizations outside of this church. And God, we're believing today that now there's going to be an abundant harvest back into our own lives. There's some people in this room right now that are needing a breakthrough financially, emotionally, relationally, physically. God, we're believing that in this time of famine, in this time where it doesn't feel like everything's going the way we want it to, we're going to step out and we're going to do something uncommon. We're going to do something that it just doesn't make sense. We're going to sow seed today, believing that you're going to bring in an abundant harvest into our life, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. We believe that you're able to do it, and we know you will, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, somebody say amen. The ushers are coming to serve you. Can we stand to our feet one more time? Let's worship God together.
I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance.
found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And you have torn apart the sea, you have led me through the deep. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh.
Come on, sing it out.
By day is a sign that you are with me. The fire by night is the guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh,
you, that has sought you out even when you were at your worst this morning. Can we just go back into that for just a moment? Father God, we just worship you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the fact that you do step out and bring us into your freedom, Lord God. No matter where we're at, no matter where we're at, Lord, you seek after us and you find us, Lord. And all we have to do is call upon your name, Lord God. And you bring us right into that freedom, Lord God. God, as we go back into this verse this morning, Lord, I ask that you would just speak through everybody here this morning, Lord God, that this would be our prayer here this morning, Lord God, that you would receive glory and honor and worship from everything that we go forth this morning.
Lord of every victory, hallelujah. Come on, sing it out.
Your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am made, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Father God, we are so grateful. We're so grateful for your goodness, Lord. We're so grateful for your goodness that seeks us out and finds us, Lord. Man, Pastor James was talking about a season of famine, and sometimes those seasons can speak to us a lot louder than the God that we serve. But when we find times like this, when we can rest in his presence and just be thankful for his goodness, these times are what rebuild us. These times are what strengthen us. These are the times when we're sowing seed in the famine. Things may not look great, and you may not feel like you have a lot to be grateful for right now, but man, can't we be grateful for the goodness of God this morning? Can we go back into that one more time, Blake, just real quick? Man, can we just sing that with our heart? Let that be our heart's cry this morning, that we can be grateful for the goodness of God. For this worship team. Man, they do good, don't they? They are amazing. Man, I am so excited this morning to be here with you guys. All right, who's excited to be in the house of God this morning? Amen. Man, I am so excited. There's a lot that we have to talk about, but before we do, I just want to address the elephant in the room, which is probably a lot of us after we've ate that Thanksgiving dinner, right? I know I feel like an elephant after all of that I've eaten. And maybe this morning some of you guys are a little tired from, what's that chemical in turkey, tryptophan? Man, how many of you are still riding that tryptophan wave? You know what I mean? Yeah, anybody in here still eating leftovers? Yeah, that's what I like to see. You know, there is weird people out there that will not eat leftovers. Are you a weird no leftover person? Blake, you don't eat leftovers?
You're not weird.
Oh my goodness. Somebody say privileged. Jeez Louise. Yeah, first world prayer. He's like, I do not eat leftovers, thank you. Does that mean, I wonder if he saved his wedding cake, the top part of it, to eat on their anniversary. I don't know. He did? Good deal, good deal. Can we just give it, let's congratulate him and Mallory on their wedding. Man, so excited about that, them starting a new chapter in their life. Man, this morning we are going to continue our series, Thanks and Giving. Anybody enjoyed this series? Thanksgiving is always one of my favorite times of year because it's that time that we have to stop and just be grateful for what we do have. I think a lot of times in life, we lose focus, right? We focus on the things that we don't have instead of the things that we do have. Anybody ever been there before? 100%. Like, I know a lot of the times, and it's not our fault always. You know, it's kind of programmed into us, whether we're looking at social media or watching TV. Everything that we watch is always telling us that we don't have enough and we need more. Am I right? Yeah. Look, I know you guys are tired on that tryptophan wave, but I need y'all to give me some feedback this morning. So make sure you're talking to me, all right? Can we practice say amen?
Amen.
All right, good, good. That's what I like to hear. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Brian Adams. I am a pastor here at Encounter Church, and I spend a lot of my time at the Hot Springs Village campus, but I am extremely excited to be able to be here. This is where me and my wife got our start in ministry, so it's a lot like coming home when I get to speak here. Always grateful to see the people that have supported us through the beginning of our ministry, and always good to be back here with you guys. But this morning, like I said, we're going to continue this series of thanks and giving. And when I look at my life, there's a lot of things that I can be grateful for. You know, if I choose to shift my focus and focus on the things that I can be grateful for in my life, there's many things that I could be thankful for. I have a vehicle that runs. Not everybody has that. I have a job that pays my bills. Not everybody has that. My kids are healthy. I can be grateful for that. Not everybody has that. I have a beautiful, wonderful wife who I don't know why. I was talking to Robert this morning before church, and I was like, you know, your wife is the best. I don't know why she puts up with you. And I was like, I guess probably the same reason my wife puts up with me, you know? But there's a lot in our lives that we can be grateful for. And this morning, I want to talk about being thankful for something that we, no matter what we do, no matter how much money you earn, no matter what you do, you can't earn it, right? It's something that is given to us freely. And that's the fact that we serve a God that seeks after us. I'm thankful for a God that seeks this morning. Anybody else in here grateful for a God that seeks after you? Man, did he find you and bring you into, just like that song that we were singing earlier, he found me at my worst and is trying to continually turn me into my best. So when I think about these seasons, these famine seasons that James was talking about earlier, and all the things that go on in life, and sometimes we get so busy and we get so distracted with the things that are negative, I like to focus on things from my childhood. And yesterday I was on my way back, a 10-hour drive from Dauphin Island. Anybody ever made a road trip with two kids, 10 and under, and a wife that is sick? Yeah, don't do it, you know? The vacation was relaxing, but the road trip, terrible. So the one good thing, the one highlight about this road trip is that we got to listen to Christmas music. Anybody already blasting that Christmas music? Come on, I ain't even ashamed. Come on, give me that Feliz Navidad. I'll sing it all day. So we were on our way back, and I'm kind of a classic Christmas. Anybody? Classics, you know what I mean? Like, just give me the classics. That's what I want to hear. It reminds me of that time. And when I think back about times like that, about times when life was a little bit simpler, right? Like, you didn't have to wake up and go to work, and you didn't have to be responsible for a wife. You didn't have to be responsible for a kids or a husband. You literally just woke up and did whatever chores your parents had, which at the time felt like too many, but now that you look back, it probably wasn't enough. We didn't have a lot of responsibility, and it's nice to look back on those times. And one of the things that I can remember from when I was a child, when I look back at my childhood and I remember all the things that I'm grateful for, and I'm resting in the fact that, hey, I had this season of my life where things weren't so busy and crazy. One of the things that I like to remember is the fact that my parents, for cheap entertainment and to basically get rid of us, would send us outside on my grandfather's farm all day long. Anybody ever had a childhood like that? Yeah, like literally just put you outside. Like, if you needed something to drink, you knew where the water hose was. And if you needed to use a bathroom, you knew where the woods were, right? Maybe for you, you didn't grow up in the country and you grew up in town. Anybody, a town person in here? Maybe for you, your parents weren't telling you, hey, come home when the sun goes down. They were telling you when the streetlights come on to come home, right? And you knew where you better be when those lights came on, because if you weren't at home, not good for you, right? When I think back about these times, and they were so fun and so carefree, we did everything from like building forts. Anybody a fort maker? Oh yeah, love building forts. Clubhouses, I never got in them because I had an older brother and I had to like scratch and claw my way into those things. Made me do all kinds of messed up stuff to do that. I still harbor some unforgiveness for those things. But when I think about times like that, there's so many things from my childhood that brought me great joy. And one game that I think that transcends all, one thing that we all did, no matter whether you grew up in town or in the county, you played hide and seek, right? Anybody ever played hide and seek? Come on. It's probably one of the greatest games ever. For those of you that don't know what hide and seek is, if you grew up under a rock, hide and seek is literally just you have a person that's counting, and it's you can count to, depending on where you grew up. I grew up in Mississippi, so like 10, maxing us out, you know. But you can count 10, 20, 30, whatever you want to count to. You have a seeker that's counting, and when they're finished counting, they have to go out and find all the other kids that are hiding, right? Anybody familiar with this? Yes, yes. Okay, so this morning, I want to talk to you about hide and seek. And you may be asking, like, why are we talking about this? This is Thanksgiving, and none of this makes any sense. But I think this morning that we are still playing hide and seek, but instead of playing with our friends and family, we're playing with God. I believe that a lot of us have taken that same knowledge that we had from hide and seek, and we're using it to hide from God. So my first question for you this morning would be, why do we hide from God? Anybody got any answers? Why would we hide from God? Well, just like any other time when we have questions, I always like to look to the Word. And God's Word tells us in Genesis 3, 7 through 10, it says, "Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord as he was walking in the cool of the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, 'Where are you?' He answered, 'I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. If I ever come looking for you and you're naked, please hide.'" You know, like, look, if I come knocking on your door, I'll wait a second. Just go put some clothes on, okay? So I can't blame Adam and Eve for hiding as they were naked. But I do find it funny that the first thing they did was hide. And to put this story into a little bit of context, maybe you're here this morning and you don't know what happened before this, but God had created everything, right? He created the heavens, he created the earth, and then he created the stars, the sun, the water, the oceans, everything. He created it all from nothing. And then he puts Adam here, right? And things are great, but then he realized Adam needs a partner. So he gives Adam Eve. And everything's amazing. They're literally just like walking in the garden, having a relationship with God. Can you imagine literally just getting to walk with him daily? We do have that privilege, just not exactly the same way that they did. But even after all of this, the enemy convinces them, he deceives them to sin. And that brings us to where we are now. They're hiding from God. And I believe that they're hiding from God because of the guilt and the shame and the condemnation that sin brings into our life. You know, there is a very strange phobia out there called gymnophobia, and you may be wondering what that is. Gymnophobics are people that experience anxiety from nudity. Even if they realize their fear is irrational, they may worry about seeing others naked, being seen naked, or both. Their fear may stem from a general anxiety about sexuality, from a fear that they are physically inferior, or from a fear that their nakedness leaves them exposed and unprotected. That is a super strange phobia, and I know a lot of you are wondering why we're talking about that in church this morning. But the truth is, I believe that a lot of us have spiritual gymnophobia this morning. I believe that we're afraid or we're anxious that God will see us in our spiritual nakedness. We're afraid that he may see us unprotected and exposed before him, right? Anybody ever been there before? I know I have. I know I've been there before whenever sin was in my life, and I was afraid to go before God because I was afraid of what he would do to me. Like I said, I believe that we have spiritual gymnophobia. But here's the funny thing. God already knows your weaknesses, right? Yeah. Come on. God already knows our weaknesses. And look, not only does he know our weaknesses, but he wants to use them for our good. Does anybody believe that this morning, that God wants to use your weakness for your good? 2 Corinthians 12, 7 through 10 says, "Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh." And this is Paul. He's talking about a thorn in his flesh, which is up for debate what that is. "A messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, and in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" This morning, you know, a lot of times at Encounter Church, like the things that we talk about are the three encounters. You want to have an encounter with yourself, you want to have an encounter with others, and you want to have an encounter with God, right? So this morning, if you're having an encounter with yourself and you're having that man in the mirror moment, and you look at your life, and just like these seasons that we're talking about, these famine seasons, how many of you can say that you're grateful, that you delight in weakness, that you delight in insults, that you delight in hardships, that you delight in persecutions and in difficulties? I can't look at myself in the mirror and tell myself that I always delight in those things, because I'd be lying to myself. Whenever trials and tribulations come our way and insults, difficulties, whenever we're weak, those times don't feel good, right? Those are the times that a lot of times I think that we want to hide from God. We want to hide our weaknesses from him. But God doesn't want you to hide your weakness. I had a pastor one time who told me, if you're ever around me, you'll hear me say it 100 times, and I'm going to say it 100 more. But he wants to turn our pain into our purpose. I had a pastor tell me that one time, and it stuck with me, and it'll be with me for the rest of my life because it greatly impacted me. I look at my own personal life, my wife and my life and my head. Oh, my gosh. All right.
You got it, Brian.
All right. There we go. So I look at my life, and I look at my wife's life. Say that 10 times fast. It's super hard to do. I don't know why I had a hard time getting that out. But when I look at our life, there was definitely a time period in our lives that we could be ashamed of, that we were really weak. Both of us sharing a background in addiction, and there was a point in our lives where that was something that brought extreme shame to us, something that we were embarrassed to talk about in front of people at church because that makes you weak, right? Like, that makes you not a good person. You sin, right? Like, that makes you a weak person. But God took that weakness and used it for our good. Whenever we came to Encounter Church, James gave us an opportunity. Obviously not like right away. He wasn't like, hey, you guys are recovered drug addicts. That's great. Lead our youth ministry, you know. We had been recovered for a while, but we got the opportunity to serve in youth. And man, did God use our pain for our purpose in that season. Both me and my wife had a lot of trauma that we dealt with whenever we were in our teenage years. And when we got the opportunity to serve in a youth group, we had the opportunity to help kids grow through those things and deal with those things in a healthy way instead of taking the wrong path like we did. God turned our pain into our purpose. When I look at the Bible, I look at examples like Moses. Moses was a lot like me. He had a speech impediment. You know, he just couldn't get it out sometimes. But God took that weakness and gave him somebody to speak for him. He gave him his cousin. There's different things in life that we might be trying to hide this morning from God. Maybe for you, it's your drug addiction. Maybe for you, it's pornography. Maybe for you, it's unforgiveness. There's so many different things in our lives that can make us feel that shame and that guilt, and we try to hide those things from God. But this morning, I believe that God wants us to give those things to him so he can take our pain and turn it into our purpose. I find it funny that the second thing that Adam and Eve did was sew coverings for themselves. Like, why is this even included? Like, if I was naked, I would want some clothes on too, right? But I think there's more to it than the fact that they were sewing fig leaves to themselves, or not to themselves, because that would be even weirder. They were sewing fig leaves together to make clothes for themselves. But I believe that that's symbolic of the way that we cover ourselves, right? Man, whenever we look at those things in our lives that we're ashamed of, maybe it's that addiction or maybe it's that unforgiveness, a lot of times we try to cover ourselves with works, right? Like, we try to cover ourselves with serving God in a ministry area, which is good, right? With the right intention, it's good. But it's not good whenever God's coming to us and asking us to deal with something and we're saying, wait, hold on. Look, this is what I do, you know. This is what I do at church. Did you see me out in the parking lot? I'm the best greeter they have. I'm out there waving my hands off, Lord. Do you not see this? I'm a good person. We hide ourselves behind those coverings that we make for ourselves. Maybe for you that this morning, that's trying to be the perfect mom or the perfect dad. Anybody in here a perfect parent? Come on, raise your hand, because I need you to write a book. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not good at this. I promise. My kids are messed up. I don't do it great all the time. I try the best I can, though. When we hide behind these things, though, when we hide behind these trees, these coverings that we make for ourselves, We can only see God through the leaves that we put in front of him. When we hide from God, we start to filter everything he is trying to show us or speak to us through insecurities that we hide behind. We start to become fearful of God. We don't want to hear from him or see him because we're afraid of the things he might do to us. We put a false identity on God of him being like a big fly swatter in the sky waiting to just swat us whenever we do something wrong. Or maybe you see him like a principal in the principal's office, and when you go in there, he's going to do something to punish you. But this morning, I have a scripture for you, if this is the way you feel. It's 1 John 4:18, and it says, "There is no fear in love. Dread does not exist, but perfect, complete, full-grown love drives out fear, because fear involves the expectation of divine punishment. So the one who is afraid of God's judgment is not perfected in love and has not grown into a sufficient understanding of God's love." Man, is that scripture encouraging or what? It literally says that punishment, it says love drives out fear because fear involves the expectation of divine punishment. Man, I feel like that's the place a lot of us are a lot of times with God. We're afraid of what he's going to do to us. But if we had a full understanding of God's love and how he seeks after us, then we would be running to him whenever we make mistakes and expose our weakness to him so that he could fix us and bring corrective action. I believe that God brings correction, not punishment. He wants to see us flourish in the purpose that he has created us for. Just like my wife and I, if we would have taken that season of our life that was so shameful and something that we were embarrassed about and we tried to hide it for so long, we would have never had the opportunity to serve in the way that we did. But I believe this morning that God is saying, come out, wherever you are. I'm sorry, there's just no uncreepy way to say that. Like, look, there's one thing that I've learned as I was going through this message, and that's that hide and seek doesn't age well. And if you don't believe that, then go to a park and try to play hide and seek with a bunch of random kids. Like, somebody's going to call the cops on you, especially if you're saying, come out wherever you are, okay? But Genesis 3:9 tells us, "But the Lord called to Adam and said to him, where are you?" I believe that God's calling out to you this morning and saying, where are you? Where are you, worship leader? Where are you, our volunteer for teens? Where are you, the person that needs to be in the parking lot? Where are you? Are you hiding this morning? God needs you. He wants you. He wants you to flourish in the purpose that he has created you for. Psalms 33:13 says, "From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all of mankind." You know, when I look at this story about Adam and Eve and they're hiding from God, like, how many of you know that's just extremely silly? You know, like, God knows everything and they're trying to hide from him. I'm always thinking, like, why would you even attempt to do that? You know, like, that doesn't even make sense. But then I have that man in the mirror moment and I'm like, oh man, I do that a lot too, you know? And I think that that's where a lot of us are. But we have to understand that just like this psalm tells us that God looks down and he sees everything that's going on. He's not surprised by anything that happens to us in our life. I promise you, there's people out there that I feel like they don't want to expose themselves before God because they think that, man, he doesn't know what I did. You know, this is terrible. I'm a bad person. I promise you, God still wants to use you. I believe that God is calling out to us. The real question is, will you answer him? Will you come out from hiding this morning? Let me ask you this. So we were talking about hide and seek, and when we were kids, anybody in here ever had like that perfect spot, that perfect hiding spot? Yeah? Like maybe it was in the washing machine or, you know, don't hit start, don't do it. Behind the refrigerator, I don't know. Wherever your perfect spot was, you had that perfect spot where you could sit there, right? And what happens? They're like coming around saying that creepy deal, like come out wherever you are. And you're just in your hiding spot. And it's so nice to know that they're walking right by you and they can't find you. You know, like how satisfying is that? You're like, man, they must be dumb. They don't know I'm in the dryer. And you're the one that's dumb because you're in the dryer, you know. But man, a lot of us have that secret hiding place. And I think that we still do. I think we still have that secret hiding place. But instead of hiding from our friends, we're hiding from God a lot. So maybe you hid so well sometimes that the game continued without you even knowing. I think that's the same place a lot of us are in. I think that we're still in hiding, and guess what? The game is going on, whether we're involved or not. But now is our opportunity to come out of hiding, just like Adam and Eve did, find God, and get planted and rooted on the path that he has for us. So maybe we're afraid this morning. Maybe we're not afraid of what God will say, but maybe we're afraid of what others would say in the church. Everybody, I'm sure there's something in your life that you've done before. By show of hands, have you ever done anything that you would not want everybody in the church to know about, right? You're like, probably this morning when I was smacking my kids on the way to church, you know? But here's the good news. All we have to do is step out and call upon his name. I promise it wasn't planned this morning. Like, every song that we were singing was talking about how God seeks after us. And man, that's just the way the Holy Spirit works sometimes. Here's the good news. I think that all of us, all we have to do is meet God where he's at. All we have to do is make that conscious decision to go out to him. And Adam, just like Adam and Eve, he will work those things out in our life. But we can't expect God to fix what we won't give him, right? Like, how many of you in here have kids? Parents, any parents in the room? Man, I've got a 2.5-year-old, and he is a boy, and that is 100% different than having a 2.5-year-old girl. I mean, am I right? Like, I don't even understand. Like, he just breaks things that it's like, how, you know? But sometimes I'll look at him, and he'll be playing with a toy, right? And he'll tear it up or break it, take a piece off, and he just sits there, and he's trying to figure it out forever. He's trying to figure out how to put the arm back on the G.I. Joe or whatever he's got going on, because he's literally like a tornado. Whatever he's got going on, he's always trying to fix it himself. And I'm looking at it, and I'm like, that's so simple. I could fix that easily. Just give it to me. I think that God looks at us the same way. I think that he sees us making everything we can or trying to fix a situation, and he's looking at us saying, if you would just give it to me, I could fix it so easily. This morning, I believe that it's time for us to stop hiding and start seeking. Mark 16:15-16 tells us, and he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel, the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not will be condemned. Man, that sounds a lot like hide and seek to me. They were going out and finding the people wherever they were hiding. You see, after the good news is after we're found, then God fills us with the Holy Spirit and we get to become seekers. Do you remember that game when you were a kid and somebody found you? What happened next? Then you got to go find others. God wants to use our extensive knowledge of hiding places to go out and seek after those who don't know him yet. Just like my wife and I, in our experience, whenever we were able to go out and get involved in that teen ministry, we knew all the good hiding places. We knew all the things that they struggled with because we had been through them ourselves, and we were able to use those for the glory of God. He just wants to see them set free as well. So this morning, the last thought that I want to leave you with is that God wants to be our hiding place. Is anybody grateful that God wants to be our hiding place? Man, I am so extremely grateful that God wants to be our hiding place, because the truth is that it's not easy being a Christian. I think that that's the greatest lie that we have ever sold people from the pulpit, is that being a Christian is an easy thing to do. It is not an easy thing to do. You will have trials and tribulations. The Lord literally tells you that in the Word. I was reading this morning out of Matthew, and it's Matthew 5, verse 11. It says, God blesses you when people mock you and persecute you and lie about you and say all sorts of evil things against you because you are my followers. Man, that tells me that the way that I'm marked as one of his followers is by those things following after me, persecution. These things happen whenever you're a follower of God. But Psalms 32:7 tells us, you are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with the songs of deliverance. Psalms 119:114 tells us, you are my hiding place and my shield. I wait for your word. Man, my question to you this morning is the Lord your hiding place? Or do you have somewhere else you're hiding in shame? All you have to do is call out to him. Maybe you're here today and you're lost and you're looking for a savior and you don't know who this Jesus is or this God is that we're talking about. He's looking for you. He's seeking after you. All you have to do is reach out to him. Call upon his name. Maybe you're here today and you're still hiding behind some things. Guess what? God is seeking after you as well. Don't hide in your guilt and your shame from your sin, because God already knows your weaknesses and he wants to use them for your purpose. Maybe today you're here and you're ready to start seeking after others. Man, what an opportunity you have. What an opportunity you have to get plugged in here at Encounter Church. There are so many different ways that we can use you to be able to, or God can use you to be able to help seek after others, whether that's in youth ministry, e-kids, the parking lot, taking up offering, being up here on stage leading worship. There's so many different areas that you could be seeking after other people. My last thing that I'm going to leave you with today is this. I believe God sent Jesus just for this purpose, to seek after us. That's why I'm extremely grateful for a God that seeks this morning. Luke 19, verse 10 says, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost." You know, I think about this story in the garden often, and I think about like how victorious the enemy must have felt whenever he tricked him, right? He probably felt like, this is the best. I'm already winning. This is good, you know? But he didn't realize that God already had a plan and a purpose in place to bring Jesus to forgive us of our sins. With every head bowed and every eye closed this morning, if any of these are you, maybe today, like I said, you're lost and you're just looking for a savior. You don't know who this God is that we've been talking about, and you have a lot of questions about that. I'd ask that you just raise your hand so that we can be praying with you and pray for you. Thank you so much. Maybe this morning you have salvation, but you feel like you're hiding behind some things. Maybe you feel like there's some things in your life that you're ashamed of. I'm here to tell you this morning, God doesn't care. He wants to move on and grow you from that. If that's you this morning, I'd ask that you would just raise your hand so that we can be praying with you and praying for you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Father God, we worship you. We praise you. We thank you for the fact that you seek after us, God, even when we're hiding from you, Lord, hiding in our guilt, hiding in our shame, Lord. You're still calling out to us. Lord, I'm grateful for the fact that all we have to do is call upon your name and you meet us right where we're at, God, and you place our feet on that path that you have for us. God, we worship you. We praise you. We thank you for your son, Jesus, that died on the cross this morning. God, I ask that you would be with each and every person here this morning that raised their hand, God, whether that be the fact that they don't know you as their personal Lord and Savior, God. I'd ask that you would just help them to realize the fullness of your love, Lord, that they would be able to come to having a relationship with you. Father God, I ask that if there's anybody here that raised their hand this morning because they feel some guilt or some shame about some things that are done in their life, Lord, I ask that you would just help them to know that your word tells us to come before your throne boldly, Lord, boldly, because you don't care about our weakness. You want to take it and turn it into our purpose. In our weakness, you are made strong. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
amazing, amazing day. I'm going to close a couple of announcements, but our prayer partners are here after service. If you would like prayer, maybe you're feeling that you just need to go to another place in your transparency and your openness to God. Maybe you need healing in your body. Maybe you're here today and you just need some emotional strength through anxiety and stress that you're feeling today. The Spirit of God is able to come into your life and do exceeding abundantly that you could ask or even think. And so don't leave here without getting prayer in just a moment. But before we do, don't forget the Angel Tree Giving Wall is in the foyer. This is the last day, and there are a lot of names of children out there. Make sure you grab at least one for your home and be able to be a blessing. Make sure before you take it, you don't do what I did, which is take the whole thing. You got to tear off this bottom piece and make sure that one of the people that are there have that so that they know who takes that name and can be able to track that. But we want to be a blessing to as many children as possible this year, and so make sure you take it on your way out. Also, December the 10th. Everybody say December 10th. December the 10th is a Saturday night, so we're doing a little bit different this time, but it is our next worship night at the Hot Springs Village campus. We would love for you guys to be there. It's going to be a great time together. We don't normally do a winter worship night. We usually do them all summer, but we just feel like this is a time and place that God wants to create just an environment of praise and worship. So put that on your calendar, December 10th. And then December 23rd, 24th will be our Christmas candlelight services. You're going to see all the invites already on the board. Take one on your way. Invite somebody with you. The 23rd will be in the village. 24th, Christmas Eve, will be here. So if you say, well, we've got plans on Christmas Eve, we got you covered. Be with us at the village. We worship God together. You'll see all the banners and all that will be coming up this week and be able to be a reminder to you. We love you guys. Again, if you didn't care, come on up to the front. Otherwise, find about three or four people. Tell them happy Thanksgiving weekend. Merry Christmas. God bless you. We love you. Have a great week.